Oh, there's Maggie. She's singing today.
And a hush comes over the room.
And good morning, everybody. We are glad that you are here to worship with us at Redeemer Baptist Church this morning. If you are joining us via Facebook Live, or you are watching this on a delay on YouTube, or you are here with us on Zoom, we are glad, however it is that God has led you to join us together this morning. We get the opportunity to have our worship team leading us from our streaming center into God's presence in song.
Morning, church. Who breaks the power? Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all. Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Every Sunday, we begin our service by hearing from God's word as a reminder of who God is and to help us see Jesus as worthy of all praise and affection. Hear what the Spirit through David is saying to the church from Psalm 111, verses 1 through 10. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the inheritance of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, your Holy Spirit conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in the life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in the name of Jesus.
Well, good morning once again. We want to welcome all of you to our online worship service. If you are watching the streaming center and our great musicians there, you notice that Jason looks a little bit different today. That's because Jason is on the East Coast on a vacation right now, but we have the wonderful worship leader Robert Voorhees joining us there from our streaming center to lead us in worship. And Robert, we are really thankful for you coming and using your gifts here to bless us and encourage us with those gifts. So thank you for doing that. And Maggie, we're glad that you're there to be part of our team there as well. By the way, behind the scenes, if you don't know this, if you haven't been thinking about it, let me just encourage you to think about this. To make this service happen with all of the different connections, there are a lot of people who work behind the scenes to create all of the tools that we use online, our technicians. And if you get a chance to think of them and to thank them for all of their work, I know that they would appreciate it, because it takes a lot of people to pull this off and to make this happen together each and every week. So we have a few announcements we want to share with you today that we are excited about. You know, here at Redeemer Baptist Church, everything that we do is built around our God-given vision, that we would glorify God by being a gospel-centered community of worshipers, proclaimers, disciplers, servants, and stewards. And as we think about how do we worship together in the next year, we have been working on so many different options for us. But as many of you know, beginning last week, we were able to return to Kermit King Elementary School, and it is our plan throughout the month of May to be there three different times, May 2nd, May 16th, and May 30th. We will be outdoors for those worship services. We're still evaluating what days in the summer, June and July, as you know, can get a little warm here. And so it may not be every week as we try to address those factors, but we are aware that every time we get together, whether it's online or in person, that we get joined by the living God and we get to respond to Him in song and in prayer and in the fellowship of the saints, and those are true blessings to us. So plan to be together May 2nd, May 16th, May 30th in person, and then the other weeks to be online. We have our men's small group tonight, The Forge, Food Fellowship, and probably not Fire tonight. We are going to have some weather, so we'll be at 5 p.m. at Chuck Martin's house. Chuck and Lorene Martin's house is where we'll be, rather than over at the Grazia Day home where we normally meet. So plan to be there, gentlemen. I think I've got most of your food orders for the evening. So we're going to be enjoying a good time in fellowship as we study Counterfeit Gods, a wonderful book by Pastor Tim Keller. And ladies, you guys are going to have a great evening. 4:45 p.m., you get together at Park Cinemas for a movie night. And what do you have to bring? Just yourself, or bring yourself and a friend. We are going to have free popcorn for you, a free drink for everybody, and you get to watch a movie together in your own private theater that we have rented out for you. So you're going to want to plan to be there. So if you need a ride for that, wave your hand at somebody after church and say, hey, I need you to help me get there. But I want to be there. So that's for all of the women's groups. That's in lieu of our normal women's groups. So 4:45 p.m. at the Park Cinemas, you'll want to come and be there. And speaking to our women, we are so excited about this. We are going to do an amazing event this year on May 14th and 15th for the women of our church. And we have been working very hard. Melissa Martin and a wonderful team of volunteers have been working to pull this event together. So there's going to be a study called Steadfast on the Book of James. It's going to be taught by some of the greatest women teachers in the United States. That content is going to be streamed in to Covenant Presbyterian Church, who is co-sponsoring this event with us on May 14 and 15. And there's going to be so many fun things happening at that event. You're not going to want to miss it. It's going to be Friday evening, all day Saturday. There's going to be all kinds of good food and fellowship. There's going to be giveaways of books. There's going to be craft things where you're painting and doing all kinds of things. And all while you're getting to study God's Word together with not only the beloved saints that you know here at Redeemer, but the women from Covenant Presbyterian Church. So, if you have not yet, I want to strongly encourage you as your pastor, sign up to be there. If you don't know how to sign up, contact Melissa. Melissa, wave at everybody on your camera there. There you go. Contact Melissa. She will help you get logged into the Eventbrite site and get you logged in. There is a $50 conference registration fee, but if that is a financial issue for you, we are not letting anybody be kept from participating by the finances. So you just let Melissa know. We have people who want to sponsor other women in the church for this event. So you don't worry about the money if the money is an issue for you, okay? So that's going to be a great time. You want to plan that, put that on your calendar now, get signed up now for that event together. And it's just going to be it's going to be our big women's discipleship event for the year. So let me encourage you to do that. Now, one of the great privileges that we have as a church is that we get to pray together. You know, when God's people, all of us united in heart and mind, get to go before the throne room of our Father, we need to remember that this is a huge privilege that we have through the grace of Jesus Christ. And every few weeks in our church, we pause during our service to pray not just for ourselves, but for the work and advance of God's kingdom around the world. We pray for our missionaries, our global partners, our national partners, for the advance of the gospel in places like Pearl Island, where we have gotten to know so many of our global partners and our international partners there. And that's what we're going to be praying for this morning. Right now, you may not know this, but all around the world, the Muslim peoples of this world are going through the month of Ramadan. And during the month of Ramadan, they fast all day long as a form of atoning for their sins. They will, in the evening time, go to visit friends and family members and neighbors, and they will ask for forgiveness for all the sins they've committed in the prior year against their friends. Now, that doesn't sound like a bad thing to do. Unfortunately, for them, that is a requirement for salvation. It's a way of earning favor with God and with man. It's not done as an overflow of God's grace. But you know what our global partners, our missionaries have found out, our national partners have found out, is this is a great time to share the gospel, to share the good news of Jesus Christ, that we don't have to earn our salvation. So we want to invite you to pray specifically for the Muslim peoples of Pearl Island, where 97% of those millions of people have not only not believed in Jesus Christ, they've never even had the opportunity to hear of Jesus Christ. And we're going to be praying that during this season of Ramadan, that several things will happen. One, we're going to be praying for Christians on the island to be faithful, to be salt and light, to go and visit their neighbors and tell them the good news of Jesus. We're going to pray that those people who hear that will be brought to saving faith through the Word of God. Sometimes God manifests himself in dreams and in visions pointing to the Word of God and to Christians, and we want to pray for that. And we want to pray also for those believers who live in this highly isolated environment, that God will protect them and that he will sustain them even in the face of persecution. So would you join me as we pray for Muslim peoples all over the world, and particularly those Muslim peoples there on Pearl Island? Heavenly Father God, we are humbled when we realize that we didn't earn the right to hear about you. We didn't deserve it. We were placed in a context, in a nation, and at a time where many people probably came to us and told us about your son Jesus. And we maybe didn't want to come and hear about it, but you drew us by your Holy Spirit to yourself. And we are aware that that was all of grace. And we are burdened as we think about the peoples around the world right now, in Muslim countries all over the world, hundreds of millions into the billions of people trying to earn their salvation through good works. It's a way of emptiness, a way of death. And so, Lord, we're crying out for them. We're asking that you would send visions, that you would draw through your Holy Spirit them to believers, to encounters with your word, that they might encounter the truth of a Savior who has entered into the world and lived the perfect life they could not have lived and died the atoning death that they should have died, so that they can encounter also the resurrected Savior and all his life and be brought into life itself. We pray specifically for the people of Pearl Island, where so many of our friends that we have met are working. We thank you for people like Jeremy and Andy, Uti and Yufra, Tony and Caitlin, Mitch and Sarah. Lord, we thank you that they are there, that they are working for the advance of the gospel amongst these people, and we pray that the gospel would advance, that men, women, boys, and girls would come to saving faith. We pray for other Christians on that island, that they would be salt and light, be bold and faithful, that they would take all the opportunities they're being given during this fasting season. That when the fast breaks in the evening and evening meals are celebrated together, that they would be invited. And there they would have opportunities to share good news. We pray that you sustain the faith of many of our new brothers and sisters who face persecution, oppression, exile, being outcasts. May they count it all joy as they follow a Savior who was an outcast himself. That you would sustain their faith and not let them be drawn back in. And we ask, God, that you would do a work in our own hearts. That we would not just pray once or twice for our brothers and sisters around the world, but that we would have our hearts knit to them, and that we would seek in all things to advance the gospel in our own neighborhoods, our own communities, where we face so many fewer restrictions. So, Lord Jesus, may your kingdom come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Manna. it up was he to die. It is finished was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high, hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring.
Please unite with me in our prayer of confession, assurance, and illumination. Dear Father, from a busy and bustling week, we come before you now. We come with our human hearts, pleading to touch and be touched by your divine heart. Quiet us for this communion. May we not take it for granted. We admit to being a bit, okay, a lot, soiled and stained, and ask for honesty before you as the searchlight of Holy Spirit exposes to us what is already known by you. We, apart from you, are decidedly unholy. You alone are holy. How can we thank you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, for spanning that vast chasm by sending Jesus to live among us, to die bearing the weight of all our sins, but none, not one of his own, to be buried completely dead, and oh, glorious third day, resurrected, totally alive. Please remove our sins as far as the east is from the west and exchange them for the forgiveness and total aliveness that you have for us. We do not come to you empty-handed, for even our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. We have been rebellious, stubborn, and doubting. We have not paused to listen to you during our prayer time. Sometimes we've abandoned prayer. We've been disgruntled, grouchy, and complaining, and so much else. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for your cleansing. Thank you for your renewal and redirection. We have your word on this, for you tell us that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. May these coming moments in your word change us more into conformity to the character and likeness of Christ as Holy Spirit speaks lovingly but incisively through our children's gospel message and Pastor Chris's sermon to recalibrate our hearts, minds, desires, and wills to yours. Anoint Pastor Chris with boldness, clarity, wisdom, and kindness. May his words be laced with grace and gentleness, even as they convict, chasten, and correct. Bridge heaven and earth, the temporary and the eternal, with his message today. May we risk being disrupted, disturbed, but also delighted. Help us break free from the chrysalis that has sheltered and protected us, but is no longer needed as we emerge and venture into a new freedom that you are leading us toward and have created us for. In the authoritative and all-powerful name of Jesus, amen.
Well, thank you, Gaynell, for such a beautiful prayer and reminder of the wonderful work that we want to see God do as we come together as God's people before His Word. Now, we're in this series that we have entitled Turn. The call of this series is to recognize that throughout the Christian life, in every area of life, that God is calling us to turn away from something and to Himself. We're going to look today at Mark chapter 1, verse 14 through 15. Now, if you haven't caught on, the last few weeks, by and large, we've been focused on these first few fragments of the gospel in early Mark and early Matthew. And we've been focused around these first calls of Christ. And last week we looked at Matthew's version of that in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. And today we're going to take a little bit wider lens look as we go to Mark chapter 1, verses 14 through 15. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel or the good news of God. And he was saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe in the gospel. Repent and believe in the good news. The essential part that Jesus is calling us to, if we are to be His children, if we're to be His followers, is to enter into a lifelong process of turning away from everything that we were outside of Him and turning to Him. So we've been looking at this theme for the last couple of weeks and asking the question, what does it mean to repent? And you might remember a few weeks ago, we talked about it in terms of coming home to the Father. And then the week after that, we looked at what it meant to be responding to Jesus' call as we looked at the ministry of John the Baptist. And last week, we looked at Matthew 4:17, and we focused on that segment where Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and what does it mean for our lives to be surrendered to the King? Today, we want to take that second part of what Jesus said in His early ministry, and we want to focus on what does it mean to recognize Jesus or to believe in Jesus, to trust in Him. So we're going to see today that we need to repent because our fundamental life problem, our root problem, our main issue is not actually the symptoms that show up in our life of sins, but our fundamental issue is unbelief. And we're going to see how Jesus challenges our unbelief. And we're going to see how we human beings often demand proof, but don't accept the evidence that Jesus gives us, which will lead us to a discussion of why. Why do we find it so hard to really entrust ourselves to Jesus, to really believe everything that He says? And then we're going to take a look at why and how we get to repent by believing the good news that Jesus is all that He claimed to be. So that's our outline for the day. Let's talk about this first idea that we need to repent because our root problem, our root sin, is actually unbelief. Now, you may never have been taught this. You know, our approach to so many sins in life, from gossip to stealing, to sexual sins, to violence, to anger, attitudes of selfishness and pride, is just simply to be told, stop doing that. Stop doing that. That's bad. You know, kind of like the way that maybe parents discipline a small child. Now, there's a degree of truth to that because we are called to stop sinning. Jesus did say, go and sin no more. But if we want to really experience long-term victory and transformation, we need to understand why we sin. And what if all of those types of outward sins are not actually the root problem, but the fruit issue in our life. Jesus said our lives overflow with the fruit of sin. And that's where anger and rage and slander and gossip and selfishness and all of these outward manifestations like immorality show up. They show up because they are the fruit of something else in our life. And that root that leads to that fruit is unbelief. Pastor Tim Keller puts it this way. If you've been around Redeemer any length of time, you've probably heard this, that under every behavioral sin is the sin of idolatry. And under every act of idolatry is a disbelief in the gospel. You may say, wait a second. I don't worship idols. I'm not some pagan in some far off land. But remember this, that idolatry is the replacement of God with any other source of ultimate significance, satisfaction, or security. So anytime we look to anything else to give our lives meaning and purpose or to satisfy our deepest longings or to make us feel safe, if whatever it is that we're looking to provide those realities to us, that's our God. That's our God. And it's an act of idolatry, of worshiping something other than the living God. Now, this is not a new problem for the human race. From the very beginning, we have struggled to really believe God when he speaks. Adam, Eve, you're in a perfect garden. You're in a perfect place. You have all that you need to be provided for you. I, God, will keep you safe. Your significance comes from imaging forth my glory into this world. The one thing you don't need to do is don't touch, don't eat from that tree. Well, it seems simple. Just believe. Just believe that, right? But what happened? Satan comes along and he says to the woman, you know, you can eat from that tree. You're not going to die. There's no consequence for failing to image forth God. There's no consequence for failing to trust God. You won't die if you don't trust God. And that was a lie. And then he went on to lie some more, and he said, for God knows when you eat of the tree, the knowledge of good and evil, your eyes will be opened. But they wouldn't be open. They would become distorted. Instead of seeing reality the way it actually was, they would have like sin-colored glasses placed over their eyes, and they would no longer see reality the way God actually made it. The lie that they would be like God could never have been farther from the truth. They were already like God. They had been made in his image. But seeking to usurp God, they believe the lie. And this is our beginning level problem. And here's the thing, that kind of unbelief, the unbelief that says we're not going to have to face consequences for not trusting God, we're not going to, that doubt is inherently good, that we can not trust God to provide all that we need, that leads to all other sins in our life. So just look at Romans chapter 1, verse 24 through 25, and you'll see how the Apostle Paul unpacks that. He says, therefore, God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts. God gives us over to what our hearts actually desire to the dishonoring of their bodies amongst themselves. In other words, you can take that which God gave you to image forth his reality in this world, and you can actually defile it. You can take that which is good and make it corruptible. Why? Because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie. In other words, they didn't believe God. They said, no, I would rather be told a lie and believe it that comforts me, that puts me in a position, rather than to have to trust on God. And the result was they worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator who's blessed forever. So idolatry occurs. So we are given over to all of these behavioral sins because we don't actually believe God. So Jesus shows up and he challenges our unbelief. Notice how rare it is for Jesus to just point out somebody's behavioral sin and tell them to stop doing it. It's an incredibly rare thing. Over and over again, when Jesus shows up to teach, he challenges that root level reality. He challenges our unbelief. So just think of some of the things that Jesus claimed, right? Just think of these claims and see how he's challenging our unbelief. So Jesus claimed to be the light of hope in a dark and broken world. Our sin led us into a place of darkness and disillusionment and misunderstanding. We don't see the world rightly. Jesus said, I'm the light who can help you see everything. So he says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will actually have the light of life. We go to books, we go to philosophers, we go to TED Talks, we try to listen to so many different people. We go to our grandmas, we listen to other people's opinions. We're looking for light in a dark world all the time. But Jesus says, I am the light. He challenges our unbelief. He claims to be the source of life's fruitfulness and its fulfillment. He's like, you want to have a life that's meaningful? You want to have a life that counts, that actually has some lasting reality to it? He said, I am the vine. You are the branches. If whoever man remains in me and I in him, it is he that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If you're disconnected from me, there's nothing in your life that will count. That's an audacious claim. Jesus goes on. He says, I'm going to be all-sustaining and satisfying. Can you imagine somebody making that claim to you? If you come to me, you'll never ever, Jesus said, be hungry again. You'll never be thirsty again. Why? Because he said, I am the bread of life. I'm the thing that you have always been looking for. You don't need to trust in something else to make you secure. I'm the one who can satisfy you. He claimed to be the truth about how to live. We often postulate our own opinions, our own perspectives about how somebody ought to vote, how somebody ought to be behaving, how somebody ought to be living, how they ought to manage their garden, or how they ought to act online. Jesus says, you want to know how you ought to be in your workplace, in your marriage, in every place in your life? That's me. He said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am what real life is. In fact, he goes on to say, no one comes to God except through me. He makes that claim even more explicit. He challenges our unbelief by saying, listen, I am the doorway to God's salvation. You need somebody to save you from your unbelief, and I'm it. So Jesus says, I am this door. I am the door of the sheep. He says, you're the sheep that you're out in some pasture, lost, wandering, and I'm the door by which you enter into God's presence. He goes on to say, if anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. I'm the source of everything that God has intended for you. Well, maybe you think, I'm not sure how to find that door. Well, guess what? Jesus said, I'm the self-sacrificing good shepherd that will lead you to that door. I'm going to bring you from where you are straying. I'm going to bring you from all the different places you have wandered off to. I'm going to bring you to that pasture. And then in order to make sure you can get in, I'm going to lay down my life. I want to ask you something. Who do you have in your life that you could trust to shepherd you perfectly in every thought, every decision, every situation? Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. You want to know why you can trust me? I'm going to die for you. But not just to die for you, I'm going to give you real life. Your unbelief led you to death, and I'm going to take you who are in death, and I'm going to give you life right now in the present and life forever in eternity. Jesus said outside of a grave these words, "I am the resurrection and the life." What an incredible, audacious claim. He goes on to say that if anyone would enter through him, believe in him, though they die, yet they shall also live. And everyone who believes in him shall never die. Death becomes a doorway into an eternal life. And he asks this question, do you believe this? Do you believe this? And here's something even more amazing. He says that if you'll believe in him, if you'll let him become your life, your truth, your shepherd, he will take you, because he is the transforming reality of God, and he will make you into agents of his life-giving grace. He will take those of you who have been living in death and darkness and disillusionment and frustration and living frustrated by your own sins and weaknesses and brokenness, and he will take you and make you into something else. Just think about Jesus saying this. He says, whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. He said, I am that which will satisfy your thirst. Then he says, out of your life, I'm going to put my Holy Spirit, and I'm going to make you a fountain of God's grace to other people. I'm going to take you not just into some forever heaven, but I'm going to make you into an agent of my grace in this world, that other people can experience that same grace. And of course, ultimately, Jesus' most audacious claim that challenges our unbelief is that he claims to be God. Now, if an idol is anything that we believe will give us ultimate satisfaction, significance, or security, Jesus is saying to every idol, every other thing, you are not God, I am. And that's the essence of his claim. Whenever Jesus said to a group of religious leaders at his trial, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. I am everything. Everything you've ever wanted, everything you could ever hope for. Now, here's the thing that he's trying to say to you and me. The reason you and I sin in our own unique ways is because we don't believe the claims of Jesus. We don't believe that he is who he said he is. See, deep inside the human soul, when we got disconnected, alienated from God because of our sin, we became profound skeptics. We've learned from the time we were small children to not trust everybody else's claims. Parents may claim to provide for us perfectly, yet none of them do. Parents may have claimed to protect us, yet some of them abused. Parents may claim that they, in fact, will make our lives significant, or if we achieve certain things on the soccer field all the way through the right college, through the right job, that if we do that, that our lives will count, and then we do all of that and we find that our lives aren't significant. We have become profound skeptics. We demand, therefore, that anyone who makes such audacious claims as Jesus makes, prove it to me. But what if he does, and we still won't accept the evidence? In fact, that's the situation that everybody around Jesus found themselves in, and that's still fundamentally our problem. Jesus has proven himself over and over again, but we don't accept the evidence. We're like the religious leaders of Jesus' day and time saying, hey, Jesus, prove it to me one more time. Show me yet another sign. He had already done so many different signs to prove who he was, but they wanted more. Why? Because we don't believe. We don't believe John the Baptizer's testimony. We took a look at that just a couple of weeks ago. But Jesus said, here's the problem with you guys. Here's the deal. He says, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into heaven before the religious leaders, before the religious teachers and the scribes. Why? Because you didn't believe in John the Baptizer's testimony. You didn't believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. They knew they didn't have a hope to get into heaven unless everything that John said was true, that there was one who was coming to live a perfect life that they could not live and to die an atoning death for them. And he said, even when you saw the fulfillment of what John was saying, and even when you saw these other people entering into heaven before you, you still didn't believe. Well, we shouldn't be shocked that they didn't believe John the Baptizer's testimony, because the truth is, we don't believe Jesus' self-testimony. Think of all those things that we just saw that Jesus claimed. Ask yourself, if this week you've believed those truths about Jesus Christ, when you faced a challenge, a weakness, a hardship, a temptation to sin, did you say, let me tell you, I believe this is who Jesus is? Jesus says this is our fundamental issue. We hear, just like the Pharisees, we come to him and say, if you're actually the Christ, if you're actually the Messiah, the promised one of God, tell us. And he's like, I did tell you. But even if I tell you again, you won't believe. And if I ask you questions about it, you still won't answer. We don't believe because we don't believe the inward work of God. See, God has sent his Holy Spirit into this world to convict of who Jesus is in a present reality, not just in an abstract theory or some set of truths we're supposed to mentally acknowledge or cognitively believe in. No, we don't believe the convicting work of the Holy Spirit that says, if everything Jesus said is true, how can you not trust him? Right now, today, in this moment, in this situation that you're in, Jesus said that when the Holy Spirit would come, he would convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment, concerning sin in particular, because, get this, Jesus is going to convict you of your sins, your behavioral realities. Why? Because you don't believe in him. See how Jesus makes that connection? That we sin because we don't believe in him. Here's the thing. Even when God the Father testified about who Jesus was, we don't believe his testimony either. Over and over again, God the Father would say out loud during Jesus' life, this is my beloved Son with whom I'm well pleased. Just read the few verses before where we read today in Mark chapter 1, and you'll hear God the Father testifying. Jesus himself said, God the Father who sent me has himself borne witness about me. So the triune God of the universe, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are all bearing witness that Jesus is everything he claimed to be. He has other prophets like John the Baptizer testifying, and we still struggle to believe it. We say, yes, we know what you did yesterday, Jesus, but will you do it today? Well, Jesus said his works testify to who he is. Now, the word signs in the New Testament is such a key and specific word. A sign as one of the works of God. It might include healings or feedings or resurrections or miracles, the different kinds of things like that. But notice they are signs to point people to the reality of who Jesus is. And that's the way that Jesus most predominantly spoke about his own works. He said, the works that I am doing bear witness about me. When John the Baptist was struggling, do I trust that he is everything that he claimed? John's disciples were sent back from Jesus with this message. He said, you tell John what it is that you've seen, that the lame walk, Let the deaf hear. Let the mute speak. That people are healed. Jesus is constantly proving himself. And he's doing that even now. His works in this world exist to validate his testimony about who he is. In other words, Jesus didn't come to perform, to get us to believe in him so that we could get his works. He, in fact, came and did his works so that we would believe in him. We get that backwards all the time. We demand Jesus prove that he's God by satisfying us. We're like the crowd after Jesus fed 5,000 of them that chased him down, literally chased him around the Sea of Galilee, and then said, after he's already fed them all with leftover baskets, they said, well, what sign do you do that we can believe in you? Show us who you are, and then the hint, 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 we can misuse scripture just like the best of people. You know, God gave manna every day when the children of Israel were in the wilderness. You gave us bread yesterday. How do we know to believe you today? Give us manna today. Would you ever do that to Jesus? Have you ever had him fail you yet? And yet today, if you haven't yet been tempted to unbelief, I assure you before the day is over, you will be tempted. And the big response that we so often have is to turn around and say, yeah, that was yesterday. I'm not sure I can trust you to make me safe or significant or secure today. And unbelief will invade our lives. One of our challenges with Jesus is that we're always trying to demand that Jesus save himself before he can save us. The problem with that is that the only way he can save us is by dying for us. His death is our salvation. At the cross, the religious leaders were crying out these words. They said, he saved others, therefore he obviously cannot save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross and we will believe in him. That's the way we approach Jesus. We want him to do something other than actually die for us. But what if his death is the only way we get all of those benefits that he claimed for us? Jesus says that our evil and unfaithful hearts are the reason that we demand proof. And when we let those hearts guide us, we won't even believe in Jesus, even if he rises from the dead. Jesus said, an evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign. Prove it to me one more time, Jesus. But no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. What happened to Jonah? He spent 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a whale. Jesus would go on and say that he would give them a sign of destroying a temple and rebuilding it in 3 days. What's he saying? Listen, here's, you want the ultimate sign? Watch this. I don't just raise other people from the dead. I walk out of the grave by my own power. Death has no authority over me. But you know what? Too often, just like the religious leaders, even though Jesus walks out of the grave, if we won't believe Moses and the prophets, we won't be convinced even if someone should rise from the dead. And here's something you and I need to accept, that our unbelief, not just our outward behaviors, not just our sins, but our unbelief in Jesus is actually the root of our condemnation before God. In other words, Jesus is not just condemning us because of our behaviors, but our failure to trust him. You find that in multiple places in Scripture, but take a look at Matthew 12:41. Jesus says, the men of Nineveh will rise up with the generation with this generation, and they will condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, something greater than Jonah is here. In other words, the men of Nineveh believed what Jonah was telling them, and I am something so much greater. You're condemned, Jesus says in the book of John, because you have not believed in the name of God's only Son. So here's the question that we need to ask next. Why? Why is it so difficult for the human heart to believe Jesus' claims? Why is that such a challenge for us? Well, Scripture points to several different reasons that we can maybe summarize this way. We don't believe Jesus' claims because we don't trust or know God's word. We don't trust when God speaks. You know, Adam and Eve didn't trust God in the garden, and we don't trust, certainly, the written Bible. Jesus, in fact, said, if you believed Moses, if you believed the writings of Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? See, if you won't accept the testimony of the Old Testament prophets, if you won't accept the writings in all of God's word, you're not going to trust Jesus. And the farther you get away from trusting God's word, the farther you get away from trusting the words of Jesus, because they are united. They are the same thing. So we don't believe God's word. Another reason why we struggle to believe Jesus' claims is because we don't want to do God's will. We don't want to do it. Adam and Eve didn't want to obey. They didn't want to. Here's something so fascinating. Look at John 7, verses 16 and 17. Jesus says, my teaching is not mine. It's the one who sent me. It's teaching of the Father. It's not exclusive to me. He says, but here's the deal. If anyone's will is to do God's will, he will know whether the teaching is from God. Now, think about what a great reversal that is. We want Jesus to prove he's God, and then we'll think about obeying him. He says, no, here's the way it works. If you want to do what God wants, if your deepest and most profound desires are to be pleasing to the will of God, when you come to my teaching, you will know it is from God. In other words, the fundamental misalignment whenever we don't trust Jesus' words is because we don't want to do what God wants, and we instinctively know that if we listen to Jesus, we're going to have to be different people. So we don't trust him. Here's another reason. The Bible says that we don't believe in Jesus because we seek glory from others. We're looking for weight or significance or approval in our life from people other than God. We want to trust them instead of trusting God. Well, Jesus said that as well. He said, how can you believe? How can you believe when you're in the business of receiving glory, getting your significance, your approval, the fact that your life matters from some other human being? How can you believe in me when you don't seek the glory that comes from me? If you're seeking God's glory, you're going to believe me. But if you're seeking human glory, you're not going to trust God. Now see, so often we try to paint our unbelief in intellectual arguments and profound questions, when so often it's so much more simple than that. The truth is, we want somebody else to approve of our life. We want society or the world, or we don't want to be a weirdo, a freak, somebody who's different from the way the world thinks of things. And the truth is, we don't want the glory that comes from God. The Bible also says that one of the reasons we don't believe is because our hearts are hard or shallow or distracted. Jesus told a parable of the word of God going out but not being received like seed into ground, because some seed fall on hard ground and it just bounces off and Satan snatches it away. Some seed fall into shallow ground and they have a shallow root, but they have no depth or substance to them. And some seed springs up into a ground, but it's distracted by the desire for other things, the deceitfulness of wealth. And that's why we don't believe. We don't believe Jesus' promises because our hearts are misaligned and they're not fertile soil. Here's another one. We don't believe Jesus' claims because we don't accept the truth about who we are. See, what if you went to a doctor and he said to you, you've got cancer. And you said, that's not possible. I'm not a cancer patient. I've never smoked. I follow some perfect holistic diet. I can't possibly be a cancer patient because what you're telling me, doctor, is contrary to how I see myself. Jesus says, you don't even see yourself right. That's why you don't believe my words. He's like, why do you not understand what I'm saying? Why don't you understand it? It's because you cannot bear to hear my word. You don't want to hear my diagnosis. And he says, here's my diagnosis. You are of your father, the devil. And your will is to do your father's desires. We don't like the diagnosis that Jesus makes of us, so we choose to not believe in him. Every time we are faced with a daily choice, we want to reject his diagnosis of who we are innately outside of Jesus Christ. He says, because I tell you the truth, you don't believe me. You don't believe because you don't want to hear the truth. Sometimes we don't believe because we don't want to follow a dying Savior. We don't want to follow him all the way to dying to self. I can tell you as a pastor, so many times this is where I see people's hearts go astray. We want to follow Jesus as long as we think he benefits us, but if following him means some part of us must die, some desire, some passion, something that we care about must actually die, we don't want to follow him. Jesus told his disciples that he was going up to Jerusalem to suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes. The religious leaders and all the political leaders were going to reject him. They were going to kill him. And that on the third day he would be raised. What's the response of his disciples? Peter takes him aside and begins to rebuke Jesus. I mean, can you imagine the audacity of this? You've seen Jesus bring the people back from the dead. You've seen Jesus feed 5,000 people. You've seen Jesus make the lame walk. You've seen Jesus make the blind see. But you go, you know what, Jesus? I know you got all that other stuff right. I heard the Sermon on the Mount. It was awesome. But on this one, you're wrong, Jesus. You're not going to die. Far be it from you, Lord. This should never happen to you. Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me. You are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Peter, your issue is that you've got the wrong agenda. And the reason we don't believe the claims of Jesus to be the all-sufficient, all-satisfying, all-securing, all-significance-making God is because we have a different agenda than a God who died. In fact, he goes on to say to his disciples right after that, he says, by the way, it's not just me that has to die. It's not just me that has to die. If you want to follow me, you want to believe that I'm going to give you the significance, the security, and the satisfaction that I have promised you, guess what? Here's how you follow me. You deny yourself, you take up your cross, and Luke says, daily, and follow me. The reason we don't believe God is because we don't want to die to self. But Jesus makes this promise. If you would try and save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake, you'll actually find real life. Ultimately, we may not believe because we don't belong to Jesus. See, if God has not set his affection upon you for all eternity, you're trapped by unbelief. If God has not called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, if he's not granted you faith and repentance to believe, you're not going to believe. Or as Jesus put it very simply, you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. You're not mine. Okay. So what do we do with this? All of that we have taken a look at is to come back here to Mark chapter 1, verse 15, and to examine again this truth, that we must repent by believing the good news. By believing the good news. That Jesus is all that he claimed. In other words, we must turn away. The word repent meaning to turn or to change our noose, our opinions, our feelings, our minds. We must turn away from our unbeliefs. We must turn to everything that Jesus said. We have to repent to believe his claims and promises, right? We must believe all of God's promises so that we can be whole. When Jesus is inviting us to repent, he's saying, here's the thing. I want you to repent by believing. I want you to have a changed life by believing that I am all the good news you could ever want. I can make you whole. I can make you who you were designed to be. Undo Adam and Eve's fundamental flaw and choose to believe me. Instead of yourself, the world, its philosophies, Satan, believe me. So when Jesus said, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe in the gospel, he's tying those things together. Our Puritan forefathers called repentance and faith the twins of regeneration. The necessary partners in our salvation. So what do we need to believe? Well, there's at least seven things we need to believe. We need to believe that God sent his son for us. We need to believe that in all of its fullness, not as an abstract idea, but that we believe in Jesus, the one that God has sent. This is the work of God, Jesus said. People came and says, what do I have to do to get saved? What are the works of God? And he says, you want to know the work of God? Believe in the one whom God has sent. Believe that he could live a life that you could not live. That he did trust God perfectly every moment of his life. That he did all that you ought to have done. That he loved God with his heart, soul, mind, and strength, and he loved his neighbor as himself. He never failed to trust God to be all that God claimed to be. He sent that one to live that life because you and I couldn't live it. And he did it because he loves us. So believe that God loves you. I know it's easy to believe that in theory, but do you believe that God loves you in the depths of your greatest sin, the most secret thoughts that you have, the most profound brokennesses that you experience, the most awful tragedies that you have gone through? Do you believe that in that moment, God has loved you and continues, even now, to love you? Do you know the height, the depth, the breadth, the length of God's love for you in Jesus Christ? John the Apostle said, listen, let me tell you a work that's been going on in my life. He said, I want you to know that we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. So often we run off to other significances, other places of trying to find our security, other places of trying to find satisfaction, because we believe that God won't love certain broken parts of us. So do you believe that God loves you? And do you believe that God not only loves you, but he came not only to live that perfect life, but to save you and me from the consequences of our sin? Our unbelief led us to condemnation, but listen to what Jesus says in John 3:18. Whoever believes in him, and he's speaking of himself in third person, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. In other words, believe me and you are no longer condemned. The work that I have done of living a perfect life counts for you, and I'm going to take all of your unbelief and all of the sins that resulted from it, all of your pursuits for other significance, other security, other satisfaction, and I'm going to put it on myself. Do you believe that God wants to make you his child in a new creation? A new creation. Jesus said this, but to all who did receive him, or John the Apostle said this, to all who did receive Jesus, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. You may feel like the idols you have served for so long have made you into their children. Do you ever feel like the child of fear? That you've been adopted by brokenness? That a particular sin has ownership over you? Do you know that's a lie if you're a child of God? That you can belong fully and wholly to him? That you can be made into something new? And do you believe that God is in the business of granting you and me freedom from and victory over sin? While we may remain in sin's presence, both its power and its condemnation over us have been removed from us. Jesus said this, John the Apostle says this in 1 John chapter 5, verse 5, who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? You have overcome the world. You are not bound to your old patterns of pursuing other idols any longer. Now, I understand that may not be your felt experience, but it is your declared reality that God is taking you and making you a victor over all that seems to have bound you for so long. Do you believe that God is calling you to do and to live out his great works in this world? That you have a mission when you wake up every morning because of you finding your significance, your security, your satisfaction in Jesus has put you on mission in this world? Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do. If you believe in him, Jesus has great works, great missions, great purposes for your life because he has ascended to the right hand of the Father. He's defeated death and he is working out not only your salvation, but his kingdom in and through you. And every time you and I choose to believe him to be all that will make us safe, all that will make us matter, all that will make us count in this world, and that he will protect us, we are joining him on his mission in this world. Finally, we need to believe that God is inviting us. He's inviting you and me not to experience some lesser life, but glorious satisfaction, more profound, more deep than anything this world promises. Glorious significance, glorious security. Do you believe that? That what God is on offer is better than what any idol promises? Jesus said, to a friend of his, a godly woman. He said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" I want to ask you, do you want to see the glory of God in your life this week? Do you want to see God show up? Then trust Him. Believe that He's inviting you. He's inviting you into the right kind of relationship with Him. What wonderful words from Jesus when He says, "Come to Me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take My yoke upon you. Learn from Me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Let's pray that God grants us the faith to believe that promise. Heavenly Father, can we just be honest and real that we've been lied to by the world, by Satan, friends, family, neighbors? Most of all, we've been lied to by ourselves. We've said that we can't trust You, that other things will make us count, that our security can be found in wealth or possessions. Our satisfaction can be found in so many of Your good gifts, and yet they never ultimately satisfy. We've believed that we have to make ourselves safe emotionally or physically. We've believed in other glories. And can we confess that so often we focus on our outward behaviors, because the truth is we don't want to have to deal with our unbeliefs. We don't want to have to deal with our fears, our insecurities, our doubts. So God, forgive us of that. And we're asking that as we've come before some of Your claims today, that this week, these truths will be buried deep in our souls, that we will hear Your invitation to come to You and experience all that You have promised that You will be if we will but trust in You. Would You do a work of sustaining that faith this week and helping us to live it out in such a way that the world sees that faith in us? And we will say, even that faith is a gift from You. So we ask all of this in confidence in Your promises. In Jesus' name, amen.
Savior, say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in Me my all in all. 'Cause Jesus paid it all to Him I sin has left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find Thy power and Thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
We can come to church on Sunday expecting Sunday to be the only day of worship. But the truth is that we worship all week long. Sometimes we worship our own image, maybe concerning ourselves with how others perceive us, or tying our image into how others perceive us. We might worship our careers, focusing on how we can get one up on the person next to us. We often find it acceptable worship to worship experiences, maybe by pursuing a dream getaway. Whenever we pursue something that's not God, we're worshiping that thing. And even more dangerous for the Christian heart is pursuing God for those things. Fortunately, we're blessed by a God that's bigger than our own desires. It's for our selfish pursuits that we pray a prayer of benediction or blessing at the end of corporate worship. We're asking for God's blessing to come and override the hardness of our hearts and cause us to overflow in joy and worship of God throughout the whole week. Hear now this call to service in Ephesians 3, 17 through 21, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let's bow our heads and pray to God that the words we hear today will lead to a week of worship of him. Father God, cause today's worship corporately to renew our spirit and overflow in joy and overflow in praise in our hearts for you. We ask that you would uphold our faith with hearts oriented towards Christ. Root us in love and give us the strength to comprehend the magnitude of Christ's love for us. For it's because of Christ's love first that we love others. Lord God, cause us repentance according to the power at work within us, that all of the glory throughout all generations be given to Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen. Some quick announcements. Today, the men's forge will be at Chuck's at 5, and the women's is going to be, you guys are watching a movie today at 4:45, so don't miss out. You'll be sorry you did. Thank you all for coming.